Hello guys, welcome back to Maths on African Motives. We are still on our revisions. Right now we're just going to focus on paper two. So this is Gauteng Department of Education that we are going to have our provisional examination of June 2019. So that is June 2019 paper two. And as we are given, it was supposed to be answered in 1 hour. 50 marks for that. All right, so we shall quickly rush through our questions, guys, so that we can see how we're supposed to attempt those typical questions, not forgetting your instructions and information that you're given, to be very, very careful, especially on the rounding off of your answers. And you're supposed to show all your working, whatever that you're going to be having, make sure that your working is properly shown and neatly presented so that you can be able to obtain full marks and write clearly. Well, make sure that when you are presenting your work, it's clearly presented. All right. So we are not going to waste much time, guys. This is question number one. 1.1, we are given a right angled triangle ABC. So ABC, which is A to B to C, is a right angle triangle. As we can see here, we have got what? A 90 degrees that we are having at point C, which is a right angle. So that's a right angle with sides A, B, and C. So we're keeping the sides A, B, and C, and the angle theta that we are given here. So we've got angle theta. All right. So this triangle is drawn as shown here. So from the information that we are given from this triangle, we're asked, write down the ratio of the following in terms of A, B, and C. So we are supposed to write in terms of the letters that we are given in this case. So we've got 1.11, which is cos of theta. So remember, guys, here we're just going to apply our trigonometrical ratios. Remember from our mnemonics of SOHCAHTOA, all right? We talked about the SOHCAHTOA concept. We need where there is cos, and cos is the adjacent over the hypotenuse in this case. So meaning to say the cos of theta must be equal to the adjacent over the hypotenuse, right? That's adjacent over the hypotenuse. And according to theta, remember, this is the opposite side. I said the sides are named according to the angle that you are working with, right? So you're going to name your sides according to the angle that you're working with, which is theta. So according to theta, this is the opposite side. It faces theta. It is opposite to theta. A is opposite. Then B, theta and 90 degrees, they are sitting together on this line. So they are adjacent to each other. So this one is your adjacent. Then the one that always faces the 90 degrees, we said it is the longest side, which is the hypotenuse. So there we have got everything. So we can fill in our adjacent according to our diagram. Our adjacent is B in this case, right? So that is B over the hypotenuse. According to this, our hypotenuse is C. So that is how we're supposed to answer this question. Then we move on to the following question. The sine of 90 degrees minus theta. Remember, I explained on our trigonometry that the sine of 90 degrees minus theta is the same as the cosine of theta whenever you are working with a right angle triangle. And also the cosine of 90 degrees minus theta, if it was cos like this, it is equivalent to the sine of theta. That is the opposite that you just need to know, guys, right? So if you can know this, you'll be able to answer any question. So this time we are focusing on the sine. So we're going to take these parts of sine. So if sine 90 degrees minus theta is equal to cos theta, therefore it means it is equal to the value that we calculated before, and cos of theta gave us B over C. So this one was just going to be B over C. All right. So that was our question. On 1.2, we are given make use of the diagram. So they were given a diagram below to answer the questions without the use of a calculator. So we are not allowed to use a calculator in that case. So this is the diagram that we have, guys. As we can see, we are given the point P, right? This is your point P. Remember, that's our terminal point there. And it gives us the value of X at the end point here, all right, to say what is the value of X corresponding and also the value of Y corresponding to that same point. That is from the coordinates that we are given. We've got X and Y. So this value here, it corresponds to the Y value, which is at negative 4. This value, it corresponds to the X value, which is at 3. So this simply indicates the distance from the origin. This is the origin where we are starting. To this point, that is the 3 that we see. It represents that distance 3 minus a 0. It means we've got a distance of 3 from this point up to that point. So you can just indicate it as a 3 like that instead of writing it at that point. The same thing, instead of you writing minus 4 here, you can just indicate on this line because it represents the vertical line, which is the Y values, which is at what? At negative 4. All right, so this is what I'm just simply trying to say. So now if you're given this, we can see, I told you guys from our trigonometry that whenever we've got horizontal and a vertical line meeting together, they meet at 90 degrees. They are perpendicular to each other, all right? So, and also you are given the angle theta here that you have, which is your angle theta, the one that is taken from this point up to this point, all right? Which is in the fourth quadrant. All right, so in this case, to say it is in the fourth quadrant or in the first, or in the, it's not important because here, if you have a triangle, it gives you exactly the values that you obtain, that you are supposed to obtain in that quadrant, whether it's a positive, it's a negative. So you are not supposed to worry about that. But what you need to understand, like I said, guys, is that the angle theta that you are given here, all right, is using the same properties as the angle that is inside the triangle, the one that is remaining to complete our triangle, our complete revolution. So meaning to say, as you are working with this theta, you consider it as if you are relating to this angle that is inside of what? Inside of the triangle. So according to this angle inside of the triangle, this side, which are the Y values, is our opposite, all right? According to theta, this side, we are having theta and 90 degrees. These two sides, they are adjacent to each other. And we talk of the hypotenuse in that case, which is the one that always faces the 90 degrees. So there we are given the hypotenuse. So on this triangle, we refer hypotenuse as what? As R, opposite as the Y values. So these are the Y for the Y axis. These are the X for X axis, all right? So whatever that you're going to determine from these questions, it needs us also to go back to our triangle and complete our triangle to find the hypotenuse, which is R in that case, all right? So where are we going to have the value of R? We can use our Pythagoras theorem in this case. Now we want to complete our triangle. Remember, it's a right angle triangle, and know that the hypotenuse squared is equal to x squared plus y squared. So we could talk about the x values and the y values on a Cartesian plane, all right? So it's going to be x squared plus y squared in that manner. So meaning to say that we can substitute our values, that is, we are going to have r squared is equal to x squared, that is the x value, which corresponds to 3 in that case. So this is going to be 3 squared plus the y value. The y value, it corresponds to negative 4, which is the one in the y axis, all right? So this is going to be negative 4 squared. So r squared is equal to, you can just simplify this on your calculator, or you can just simplify 3 squared, that is 9, plus negative 4 squared means negative 4 times negative 4, which is going to give us a positive 16. Negative times negative, it's a positive. All right, so that means if you add, you're going to obtain 25. Then to find R, you're going to introduce the square root to remove the square that you are given there. So that means R is going to be equal to 5. Yes, we know that the square root of any number is plus or minus, but R can never be a negative. I talked about that also on the introduction. So please bear in mind. So this is our hypotenuse in that case, which is our R, right? So you can just write 5 in that case, okay? So there we are having a 5. So it is very, very important that you have to calculate this so that you can be able to answer whatever question that you are given, because now you are having a full triangle, like the triangle is complete in terms of the sides, not in terms of the angles, because we don't have all the angles, but in terms of the sides, it's complete. We've got all the information that we need, all the sides, so we can be able to answer any question that you're given. 1.21, determine the value of 1/4 sine squared theta. All right, so we need the value of 1/4 sine squared theta. So let us see what we are going to obtain in that case. So 1/4 sine squared theta is the same as, remember, if you're given a squared like that, it means the whole of this trig that you're given, the trig ratio, is being raised to the exponent of 2. So this is same as, we've got 1/4. The sine of theta is the one that is being raised to the exponent of 2, not this 1/4. It's not part of the square. All right, so if it means this, therefore, let us substitute. We are going to have 1/4 the sine theta squared. We are back now to say what is the ratio of sine from our SOHCAHTOA, which is our ratios. The sine of theta is given as the opposite over the hypotenuse. So if the sine of theta is supposed to be given as the opposite over the hypotenuse, therefore, let us take according to the angle, like I said, you take according to the angle inside of your triangle. And your opposite in that case is the side of -4. So you're going to open a bracket, that's -4 over the hypotenuse in that case, which is our hypotenuse is 5. So this is going to be over 5 like this squared. So that is what the question is all about. So that means I can just plug in my values here. Yes, the question is, we are not supposed to use a calculator in that case. But once you're at this stage, you can just simplify this part using your calculator. No one is going to know that you've used a calculator here, because I just obtained the same value even with the one that you've used a calculator. So if you know, then you can simplify. That is 1/4 multiplied to a negative when raised to an even exponent. It becomes a positive. So that's 4 squared, which is going to be 16, 4 times 4, then 5 also raised to the exponent of 2, which is going to be 25. Remember, if I'm given a over b to the exponent of m, it's going to be a to the exponent of m over b to the exponent of m. So this is the condition that we are having. Every term has to be raised to the exponent of m. Then you can simplify. As you can see, 4 can be divided here. 4 can be divided into 16, which will be a 4. So this is going to be 4/25. So like I said, guys, once you are at this stage, you can just use your calculator straight to this value, all right? Still, you've got going to obtain full marks for that, okay? Then let us move on to 1.2. So they're saying, show that sec squared theta minus 1 is equal to tan squared theta. It's actually an identity. These ones, we call them identities. When you move to grade 11, grade 12, there are identities that you actually need to know. But in this case, or in our level, we do not worry about that. But in this case, they just want you to see that they are the same, so that you won't be surprised when you go to your grade 11 and 12 there. All right, so let us see. We are given in this case to show that the sec squared of theta minus 1 must be equal to the tan squared of theta. All right, that is, we've got two sides that we have of an equation. So once we have an equal sign, we consider it as an equation. But like I say, these ones, we call them identities, all right? But for now, I'm taking you guys as an equation, okay? So if your equation is like this, it means what you have on the left-hand side must be equal to what you have on the right hand side. Take it that way. So if you take it that way, therefore simplify sec squared theta minus 1, which is your left hand side, then tan squared theta, which is your right hand side. So I'm gonna simplify them here on our triangle, so that we can properly see where we are taking our values, so that we do not confuse each other here, guys. All right, so as we saw, our left-hand side, like I said, we're going to start with what we have on the left-hand side here, which is 6 squared theta minus 1. All right, so let us have our 6 squared theta like this, minus 1. All right, what does it mean? Can I simplify sec squared? I can't simplify sec squared. All right, but what I know is that this sec squared, it represents sec theta to the exponent of 2 like this, minus 1. This is what it means. All right. Then I talked about the sec to say it's a reciprocal identity, that a trig ratio that was being taken from cos, which is 1 over the cosine of theta. And I told you guys about the reciprocal concept to say 1 over a fraction of a over b gives us b over a. You just interchange whenever you're dividing by 1. So this was supposed to be 1 over cos of theta. But as we know that the cos of theta is the adjacent over the hypotenuse. This is the cos of theta. So the moment we say 1 over the adjacent over the hypotenuse like this, we are going to interchange because we've got a 1 over just like this part that I explained. So this is going to give us the hypotenuse over the adjacent. So in place of u, using the sec of theta, yes, you can find cos theta, which is fine, or you can take it straight to this ratio that the sec of theta is equal to the hypotenuse over the adjacent. Right, I also referred to this on the introduction of trigonometry. Make sure that you watch those videos on the reciprocal part so that you can properly have an understanding of what I'm trying to explain. But anyways, let us fill in our information. All right, let me just remove this part before we fill in. All right, so let us fill in here. So like I said, the sec of theta being the hypotenuse over the adjacent, we are going to fill in our hypotenuse here, which is 5 over the adjacent. Our adjacent here is 3, so it's going to be 5 over 3 to the exponent of 2 minus 1. All right, so that is what we're supposed to have from the sec of theta. All right, but it is sec theta squared, so you're going to square your value. That's 5 squared, 5 times 5, which is 25 in that case. 3 squared, remember I said when you're given a squared, you expand everything to the exponent of 2, then you're going to subtract a 1. So like I said, guys, yes, they're saying do not use a calculator, but at a condition like that, you can just simplify using your calculator because you've already applied a lot of things, and there we just need an answer there. So you're going to simplify 25 over 9 minus a 1 in that case, which is going to give you minus a 1. Oh, I left a 1 there. So this is going to give us 16 over 9. So this is 16 over 9. So that is what you have from the left-hand side, all right? You simplified your left-hand side. You obtained this sec, which gave us the whole of this part, all right? But I said, if truly this is an identity, okay, before I talk about that, let me conclude about this sec here. Remember, I talked about sec, and I said you can use 1 over cos, which is the inverse, the reciprocal, you interchange. Or you can just find your cos of theta. We know that cos of theta is adjacent over hypotenuse, which is the cos theta is adjacent, which is 3 over the hypotenuse, our hypotenuse, which is 5. This is the cos of theta. So to find the sec of theta, sec is 1 over cos theta. So it is going to be 1 over 3 over 5 like this. So we are back now to 1 dividing to this, where you can even use your calculator to simplify that and see what you're going to have if you don't understand this reciprocal component. So you're going to say 1 divided to, just open a bracket, that's 3 over 5 like this. You will see that you're going to obtain 5 over 3. So this is going to give us 5 over 3. So meaning to say, wherever we see the sec of theta, we can use 1 over cos theta like this way. We still obtain the same answer, just like the one that we took direct to say, instead of using cos theta, which is adjacent over hypotenuse, then we use 1 over. We can find 1 over on the formula. That is where we ended with the hypotenuse over what? Hypotenuse over adjacent. which is for sec theta. So you can use the ratio, which is for sec theta, which is fine, or you can find cos theta. Then you use cos theta now to determine what? Sec theta, okay? No problem. Let us see the right-hand side because here, remember, we want to prove that the left-hand side and the right-hand side are the same. So here, on the left-hand side, we obtained 16 over 9, all right? 16 over 9 must be equal to, we simplify the right-hand side, which is tan squared theta, all right? So let us simplify tan squared theta and see what you're going to obtain on the right-hand side, all right? So sorry for that. Let us just quickly see this part. We're gonna have our right-hand side in this case. So that's right-hand side, okay? So on our right-hand side, we are going to have, remember, we are given that as tan squared theta. So we're gonna take what we have here, which is tan squared theta, then we find its value. So remember, like I said, whenever there's a squared, it means the tan of theta, which is this part, is being raised to the exponent of 2. So that's the tan of theta to the exponent of 2, all right? So whatever that you're going to have, just have to substitute. Remember, tan opposite over the adjacent, opposite over the adjacent. So we're going to just substitute according to this, our opposite is -4. So that's -4 over the adjacent, our adjacent, which is a +3. So that's everything to the exponent of 2. So like I said, guys, if you do not understand, once you're at that stage, it is enough for you to use a calculator once you are at that stage. So you can just open a bracket, -4 over 3 like this, everything raised to the exponent. No one is going to even know that you've used a calculator at that condition. But if you know, then you can just square your values. If you understand your values, -4 to the exponent of 2, that's -4 times -4, which is going to give us a +16. Negative, that's a +. 3 to the exponent of 3, that's 3 times 3, which is going to give us a 9. So still, you can use that way. So as we can see, on the right-hand side, we are obtaining 16 over 9, which is the same thing as what we obtained this side, which is 16 over 9. So what are we concluding? We can conclude that these two, they are the same. What we saw on the left-hand side is going to be equal to what we have on the right-hand side. So therefore, sec squared theta minus 1 is equal to what? To tan squared theta. That's it. So I'm going to just have it like that. So that's sec here, guys. All right, sec. Let me just redo this. Sec squared. All right, so this is sec squared theta like that. So that is going to be minus 1 is equal to tan squared theta. Okay, so you can be able to answer any question, guys, as long your triangle is complete. As long this part of your triangle is complete, make sure that you understand everything. Write your information properly, and that will be able to help you to attempt any ratio that you are given. All right, let us check question number 2 again. We are on the trigonometry. Use your calculator to determine the value of the following correct to 2 decimal places. All right, so let us just try to see it here. So we're given here a sec of 40 degrees. All right, so that is 2.1. Remember that the sec of a number is 1 over a cos, sec from cos, all right? Cosec, 1 over sine, but sec, it's 1 over cos. So this simply means we've got 1 over the cos of 40 degrees in that case, all right? This is 1 over cos plus this part, there's nothing that you're going to do, just rewrite as it is, all right? So that's the tan of 50 degrees under the square root. There's nothing that you're going to do here, minus this one. Remember how you present it on your calculator is going to be 3 over the sine of the angle. Remember what I said, the sine of the angle to the exponent of 2. So it will be the sine of 28 degrees to the exponent of 2. All right, being multiplied to 1 over 4 cos 62. So this is 1 over 4 cos of 62 degrees. Actually, I was then supposed to rewrite like this. Actually, I was just supposed to show you on the calculator, guys. Let me just show you on the calculator. It's not a problem. So this is what you're going to have, because they're saying use a calculator here. So you're going to have 1 over cos 40, this part here. That's 1 over the cos of 40 degrees. So as you can see, whenever you press a trig, it opens a bracket for you. All right. So just close that bracket. Plus the tan, gonna have it's the square root, actually. Sorry, got a square root there. So it's gonna be the square root of tan. As you can see, it opens a bracket automatically for you. Close that bracket and just move aside. Do not write anything, just move this comma, because you are still inside of the square root. So you just move aside like this once. All right, then you can press minus. All right, here at this point, so you're gonna press minus. So we have what here? We've got minus 3 over sine 28 squared. So this is minus 3 over sine 28. It's inside a bracket. So you open a bracket for that sine 28. So this is the sine of, so take note, once you open the bracket to show that sine is inside the bracket, the calculator is automatically opening a bracket, all right, which is 28 like that. So you close the bracket that was automatically opened by the calculator. Then you close your own bracket, this one that you opened. You are the one who opened this, so you have to close it there. Then you square it, because it's a sine squared, okay? Then you move aside. You don't multiply here. You move aside like this. You move aside so that this will be on top, all right? Then you multiply, all right? So there you're going to multiply by 1 over 4. So you're going to multiply by 1 over 4 like this, all right? Cos of what? Cos of 60. So like I said, this was down here. So you just move it on top like that once. So it will be cos of 62 degrees like this. All right. So this is going to give us 0.799, something like that. So you can round off. They're saying to 2 decimal places. So you can just round off on your calculator, shift, go to the setup, then 6. It fixes everything. All right. So if you want to round off to 2 decimal places, you can just press 2 here. So it will give you 0.80. All right. So that means in this case, we are going to obtain 0.80 to 2 decimal places. All right. That's 0.80 in that case. All right. So that was this one was just a direct question, guys. The use of a calculator. Only important part was this part here, which was from the SEC. And this part where there's a squared, there you're supposed to present on your calculator properly. All right, question number 2.2, you're given now to solve for theta correct to 1 decimal place. All right, correct to 1 decimal place. This time they're saying to 1 decimal place, not 2 decimal place, but to 1 decimal place. So I'm just going to take this part. That is 2 marks from 0 to 90. From 0 to 90, it represents an acute angle. And that's a reference angle that you're simply talking about. I think I talked about this, guys, on our introduction of these trigonometrical equations. But anyways, here we're just going to solve. We are given the cos of 2 theta minus 10 degrees like this. Everything over 2 is equivalent to 0.091. So what you're supposed to do in this case is to find the angle, right, theta. And this part of your trig here, it represents the angle, this one. And being accompanied by the whole of this part, which is the cos of theta, the cos of this angle is a single term, all right? Which is not affected by these two, because these two is just a number. It does not affect our angle, right? So we can get rid of these two, cross multiply, or just multiply by 2 both sides. Just going to multiply by 2 this side, multiply by 2 this side, so that we get rid of these two in the denominator. So that means you're going to remain with a cosine of 2 theta minus 10 degrees, which is equal to the product of these two numbers that we have. All right, so going back to our calculator, then we just see what we're gonna have. Remember, we fixed our calculator to 2 decimal place previously. So we're gonna change our calculator to the normal mode. Then you press 2, which is now on the normal mode. There's no rounding off here because we just want to multiply 0.091 multiplied by 2 like this, right? This is going to give us 91 over 500, which is same as 0.182, all right? So that's 0.182 like this, okay? So in order to find the angle, this one, which is your angle theta, right? Where there's the angle there, where there's 2 theta minus 10 degrees. Remember, guys, what I told you to remove the cos, and you remain with the angle that you're supposed to calculate, which is what? Which is 2 theta minus 10 degrees is equal to arc cos on the other side of 0.182. So to remove cos, to be written on the other side, it will be arc cos. If it is sine, it will be arc. So there will be arc sine there, a negative one on top, right? So that is going to, we now have the angle, which is 2 theta minus 10 degrees equal to the angle that you're going to. So on this side, this here indicates the angle. On this side, this here indicates the angle, which is this one on cos here. That's your angle. But on this side, that's your angle. The arc cos, it's your angle, not 0.81. No, the arc cos, this one, it's now our angle. The whole of this part, it represents the angle. So whatever that you're going to get on your calculator is now an angle that you have. So that is going to be arc cos 0.182, like that. So this is going to give us 79, comma this and that and that. But we are given there to one decimal place. That was the instruction of this question. So I'm going to change this setup, go to the fix. I fix my calculator to one decimal place. That will be 79. Comma 5. All right, so that one is going to give us 79.5. That's 79.5, like that. All right, let us just put it this way, guys. 79.5. So you now have the angle. Remember what I talked about, that the whole of this part represents what? Represents the angle. So how am I going to find the angle theta? From the minus 10, I'm going to transpose it to the right hand side. Remember, this is negative 10 to the other side of the equation. It is going to give us what? A positive 10 on this side, all right? So we're going to add on our calculator. We are going to add in that case, all right? So remember here, we got arc cos of 0.182 to one decimal place. It was 79.5. Then we add the negative 10. Like I said, negative 10, when transposed to that side, it becomes positive. So you're going to add the 10, which is going to give us 89.5. All right. So this is going to give us 89.5. All right. Plus 10, that will be 89.5 degrees. Okay. Then that means in this case, we can obtain the value of theta. You are multiplying this side. So you divide by 2, just divide by 2 both sides. Sorry, divide by 2. Both sides here, this cancels, you obtain your theta, whereby you just have to divide here by 2. This is going to give us 44.8 in that case, right? So this is going to give us 44.8 degrees, all right? So this is the angle theta that satisfies the given equation that we had, a trigonometric equation that we were given. This was the theta that was going to satisfy everything correct to one decimal place. So this is how you play around with these typical questions. As you can see, guys, it's very, very important to understand the steps that you're going to take. All right. It's very, very important. You want to remain with the cos, which is the one that includes, or the one that has got the angle. Once you remain with that single ratio that has got a cos, or it's a tan, or it's a sine, you remove that ratio by putting it on the other side as arc cos or arc tan or arc sine of this one that you have here. It is the one that you write as arc part of that side. All right, so that was it. Without using a calculator, so this one is just a simplification that we have without the use of a calculator, determine the value of. So this is what you're supposed to have without the use of a calculator. Let us see what we got here. We need to say we are supposed to go back to our simplification of our special angles. Let me just rewrite this, guys, because I just need a space so that I can properly explain this part here. So this is given 2.3, where we are given 2 sine squared. That's 2 sine squared of 60 degrees minus the sine of 45 degrees multiplied to sec of 45 degrees. Plus 1 over 4, the tan of 10 degrees, the cot of 10 degrees, and they're saying, do not use a calculator. So the first thing that you're supposed to think of definitely here are our special angles. Those are the ones that we know the calculators are not going to be used. So that's the first thing that you're supposed to think of. All right, let me just write on top here. That's the first thing. So you know that you're going to apply our special angles on the right angle triangle. You're having the first angle of 45 degrees and angle of 45 degrees. Guys, we said if this is 1, this is 1, and this is also the square root of 2. And on the other triangle, you are going to see that this is going to be right angle triangle, 60 degrees here, 30 degrees here, where this will be 1, this will be 2, and this will be the square root of 3. Okay, so you can determine the ratio of any angle that you're given as long as it's on these two triangles, all right? So what it means in this case on the 2 sine squared theta, it simply means we have got the 2 sine of 60 degrees being squared, all right? Remember what I said here? All right, then here it means we have the sine of 45 degrees being multiplied to the sec of 45 degrees. Remember, sec is 1 over cos, all right? That is, sec is going to be 1 over cos. Or you can just use the ratio there, guys, because remember, I told you guys about the ratio. Let me not rewrite this. I'm just going to use the ratio direct, all right? Then what about this part? What is happening here? Because here we can't use any special angle there. There's 10 degrees, and so there's nothing that you can do. But we know that there's a relationship that you're going to have. This is 1 over 4 multiplied to the tan of theta multiplied to the cot of theta, which is 10. This is 10 degrees, sorry. That is 10 degrees being multiplied to the cot of 10 degrees. And I understand that the cot of 10 degrees means 1 over tan. Remember, cot, it's 1 over tan. So it's going to be 1 over tan, 10 degrees. So there's a miracle that can happen here because this tan is in the numerator on top. So it can be written as over 1. So it can cancel the tan 10 degrees, and the tan 10 degrees we're going to cancel. So you obtain a 1. So that's going to be 1 over 4 times 1, which is 1 over 4. So the whole of this part here that we have, it is simply giving us what? 1 over 4. There's no simplification that you're supposed to do here. They just wanted you to apply your basic conversion that you understand between the ratio of a tan and the ratio of a cot. All right, so like I said, on this part, I'm not going to change because we understand our ratios, guys. Let us put on together our Sokatoa concept, right? So this is what you simply have on your Sokatoa concept, all right? We need the sine of 60 degrees, whereby this is the angle that you're focusing with. According to 60 degrees, this side that faces 60 degrees as our opposite. So there we've got the opposite. According to 60 degrees, this side is the adjacent. 60 degrees and 90, they are adjacent to each other. Then that's our hypotenuse, the one that faces 90 degrees. So we've got the hypotenuse on that case. All right. So meaning to say, from the ratio of sine, which is supposed to give us the opposite over the hypotenuse, in this case, from the sine of theta, we're supposed to have the opposite over the hypotenuse. That means we are simply supposed to substitute on the sine of 60 degrees. We are supposed to have sine of 60. That is supposed to be the opposite. According to 60, we say the opposite is the square root of 3. So this is going to be the square root of 3 over the hypotenuse, which is our hypotenuse is 2. So this is over 2 like this, everything being raised to the exponent of 2. All right, we move on to the other part, which is the sine of 45. So this is going to be minus the sine of 45, meaning to say we are talking about the angle that we have here. So we're going to talk about this, or you can talk about this angle. Depends with which one are you want, are you to refer to. All right, are you to refer to this or to refer to this? So as for me, I'm just going to refer to this 45 degrees. So according to this, my 45 degrees here, this side is my opposite. All right, so I'm just going to fill in. I'm having my opposite, just like this triangle. This is my adjacent, all right? So this is my adjacent, and this is my hypotenuse. So I'm just going to fill in whatever that I'm given the sine. Remember, I said sine is opposite over the hypotenuse. So the opposite, according to this, it's 1. So it's going to be 1 over the square root of 2, which is our hypotenuse, opposite over hypotenuse, all right, which is the square root of 2, multiplied to sec 45 degrees. All right, what the sec represents? The sec of theta, like I said, it's 1 over the cos of theta. We talked about this in our previous simplification. And I told you that if it represents 1 over cos theta, it's a reciprocal of cos theta. Cos theta, it's adjacent over the hypotenuse. So the reciprocal of this is 1 over, you interchange what you see here. So it will be hypotenuse over adjacent. This is the ratio for sec theta, the reciprocal of this part. So it's now hypotenuse over adjacent. So meaning to say, on sec 45 degrees, I'm going to need hypotenuse. Our hypotenuse is what? Is the square root of 2 over the adjacent, our adjacent, which is what? Which is a 1. So this is what you're going to have, plus a 1 over 4 at the end. There's nothing that you're going to do there. All right, so we have simplified this from our special angles. They help us a lot to obtain this. And remember, this is just a single part. We just have to combine this. All right, so you're going to have this as the square root of 2 times, divided to the square root of both, you're multiplying. So you can cancel the numerator and the denominator. So you're going to obtain a 1 on this part. All right. And at this stage, if we simplify properly, we are supposed to obtain 2 times the square root of 3 squared, means the square root of 3 times square root of 3, which is 3 over 2 squared, which gives you a 4. Then you multiply this, which is going to 2, 1, 2, 2, which is going to be 3 over 2. But like I said, at this stage, guys, just use your calculator. What they do not want is for you to automatically use your calculator to simplify this. That is what they do not want. But at these stages that you see here, once you are at this stage, use your calculator to simplify this one. All right. So that's we're just going to go back to our calculator again. All right. So let us save our calculator here, guys. And I'm just going to go back to the normal mode, because remember, we fixed our calculator before. So you go back, shift, set up, you go back to the normal at 8, so that your calculator is now in its normal state. All right. So this is 2 into the square root of 3. Just move aside, then press the fraction over 2 like this. All right. Move aside again, then you square this. So this gives you 3 over 2, just like what I said on that part. So this is going to be 3 over 2 minus the whole of this part here. It gave us a 1. As we saw, those two canceled each other. Then the last part, which is a 4. So we are going to combine what we have, which is 3 over 2. That is 3 over 2 minus 1 plus 1 over 4 like this. So we are going to obtain 3 over 4 at the end. All right. So this is how you're supposed to attempt this typical question that you're given. So as we can see at the end, we are saying the whole of this part that we had is going to give us 1 over 4. This is supposed to be one and the same thing that we are supposed to get from our calculator. If we were to use our calculator direct, we are supposed to prove that. So this is 2 sine squared. Like I said, you can write it like 2. We just want to prove this 2 sine, open a bracket. Okay, it opens a bracket for you, then close it. 2 sine squared 60 minus sine 45. So this is minus sine 45, close the bracket. Then we have got the sec of 45. Remember, sec, it's 1 over cos. So it's times 1 over cos of 45 degrees like this. Then move aside, plus 1 over 4. All right, so you're going to have plus 1 over 4 like this. The tan of 10 degrees. So this is the tan of 10 degrees, close the bracket, times cot 10 degrees. So this is times cot, which is 1 over tan. So it's 1 over the tan of 10 degrees. We just want to see if our calculator was just going to simplify it once. As you can see, we've got the same answer, 3 over 4, which is the same as the one that we had to do separately and applying our special angles. So our like I said, special angles, they give us exact values as what our calculator is supposed to do. So that is why we refer them as very, very, very important angles in our trigonometry, in fact, in our mathematics. All right. On question three, you are given 3.1 on the answer book sheet. Sketch the graphs of f of x, which is equal to sine of x plus 2, and g of x, which is 2 cos x, on the same set of x's from 0 to 360. The intercepts on both x's and the turning points should be clearly indicated. All right, so there I just went further, guys, for and used or took this part. It was not part of the question paper. I just took this one from another part so that we can use it to sketch our graphs. So we're given two graphs that we are supposed to consider in this case, f of x, which is equal to sine x plus 2. All right, so let us just consider maybe just down here. So we've got f of x. Yeah, but these are the two graphs that you're given, f of x, which is sine of x plus 2. Then we also have another function, which is of gx, which is 2 cos x, right, from 0 to 360. That's, we have got gx, all right? So we also have our gx, which is 2 cos x, right? And our x is being taken from the interval of 0 degrees up to 360 degrees like that, all right? So the condition that we have here is that we are supposed to draw, we are supposed to sketch these graphs, which is true. And I told you guys, we can actually use our tables showing, remember the graph of sine and the graph of cos. I told you that these ones, they are separated by an angle of 90 degrees. As you are to draw these graphs, or as you are to sketch this graph, you separate them by angle of 90 degrees, 90, 90, 90, 90, and so on. So that's where we are going to have 0 degrees, 90 degrees, 180, you add 90 up to 360. So in actual sense, what you are supposed to have is to simply have a table from 0 to 360. So I told you guys, you can use the table that is the one that you see on your calculator, which is fine, or you can just take your table straightforward. These values, they are not many. They are just the four values, guys, that you just need to substitute on your calculator. The value of x, obtaining the value of y. They are just four values, just the four. Look at this, guys. We're just going to substitute. They're going to be what? 5, 0 degrees, of which that one, guys, we can't consider it. All right. 0 degrees, 90 degrees, 180 degrees, 270 degrees. All right. 360 degrees. So where do I get these values? Like I said, our angles for sine and cos, they are separated by what? By 90 degrees. So you start with the zero, you add 90 degrees, you write it 90, you add 90 degrees, and so on up to 360, all right? So now you're just substituting on your calculator, all right? I'm going to show you another method that you can use of a calculator direct to draw your table for you, all right? But here you can substitute our angles. If x is 0 degrees, you substitute. So this is the sine of x, which is 0 in this case. So this is the angle. Whatever that you have, you are going to add 2. 2 is not an angle, all right? So this is going to give us a 2. You move on to 90 degrees, you do the same thing, just substitute, put 90 degrees here, that will be a positive 3. You move on to 180 like this, you do the same thing, which is going to give us a positive 2. 270, you do the same thing at 270 here, which is going to do the same thing, which is a positive 1. 360, you do the same thing at 360 degrees, which is going to give us the same thing, which is a 2. So this is what we're supposed to actually have on this table from our sine of x. All right, so like I said, I'm just going to conclude with a single table that you can have on your calculator. So let us finish with cos. We do the same thing on the cos of theta. Our angles being separated by 90 degrees means we are going to start from 0 degrees, and so on and so on and so on and so on. All right, so let me just use this. 0 degrees, 90 degrees, 180 degrees, 270 degrees, up to 360 degrees. Just like that, guys. You fill in this part. It is not a matter of fact at all. All right, actually, it's not a matter of fact, this one. So just substitute your values. This time, you are working with a cos of theta. You are working with a graph of cos, so you're going to change this to a cos. So this is 2 cos theta. Our first angle is 0, so that's a 0 like that. So that's 2 cos, which is what? At 2. So this will be at 2. We move on to 90 degrees. We do the same thing. Our angle this time is now 90 degrees. That will be a 0. You move on to 180 degrees. You do the same thing at 180 degrees, which is a negative 2. You do the same thing at 270 degrees. You do the same thing at 270 degrees like this. You obtain a 0. You do the same thing at 360 degrees. You are going to do the same thing, which obtains or gives you a 2. All right, at 360, that's going to be a positive 2. All right, so like I said, we could have obtained the same thing or the same presentation like this, the one that you see here, if we could have used our calculator straightforward. So how do I do that? All right, I go to the mode here. So on this mode, we have got the compact mode, which is the one that we are using right now. All right, we've got so many. You can write in complex, in base, whereby we can deal with the even number bases, complex numbers, all right? Matrix, vector, and so, but as we want to draw a table. So you go to 7 on the table there, so it's 7. So it gives you f of x, which is your function of x. So you're going to press your f of x, which is sine x plus 2. So you're going to have it as sine. How do I obtain x? I obtain x from this here, this one, in this bracket. So to access this, it's shift here. I press my x plus 2, all right? I'm done. This is my f of x as it is. Whatever you see here, it must be as it is on your calculator, okay? You go on to gx. You do the same thing. So you're going to have our gx here. So remember, this is our gx, 2 cos x. So it gives you gx there. So it's 2 cos. Remember what I said about x. It's alpha. Go to the bracket. Close that. You've got your x there. So this is your gx. So it will give you a start. So a start there is where your interval is situated from 0 to 360 degrees. So this is your start. You are starting from 0. You are ending at 360 degrees. So that's your end. All right. So your start there, you're going to press 0 degrees. All right. You press equal to the end. It gives you the end value, which is 360 from your interval. So the end is 360. Press equal to. The step is the one that I always say, the graph of sine and the graph of cos, they are separated by 90 degrees, separated. That is your step, the one that you are using, like 0, 90. So the step is 90 degrees for the graph of cos and the graph of sine. You use 90, all right? For tan, you use 45. So that's your step, 90 degrees equal to. So it gives you a table, guys, a table that shows you the x that you substituted corresponding to your f of x. Let us compare with f of x and see. This is our f of x here. So you just want us to compare. Sorry for that. Here, this is our f of x. 0 versus 2. So this is 0 versus 2. 90 versus 3. This is 90 versus 3. 180 versus 2. 180 versus 2. You move down here. 270 versus 1. 360 versus 2, which is the one. If you go to gx, we're going to see the same thing corresponding to gx. We're going to have the same thing on our gx here, right? This is at 0 versus 2, which is 2, 90 versus 0, 180. So you just need to know this. Then you take your table as it is. You draw your table. Then you can mark your points. So as you can see, we can obtain the same thing or the same layout as this from our calculator, but it gives us as a vertical line, but as we draw it in a horizontal manner like that. All right, so anyways, guys, either way, you are going to draw your graph from those tables that you have constructed or that you have here. So let us mark our points. We have got 0 versus 2 at 0 degrees. Our point is going to be 2 here. That's at 0 degrees, 0 versus 2. 90 versus 3, that's 90 versus 3 at this point here. 180 versus 2, that's 180 versus 2 here. Mark your point, 2. 270 versus 1, so this is 270 degrees versus 1, which is 270 versus 1. 360 against 2, 360 against 2 here. You mark your point at 360 against 2. So these are the points that you're supposed to join. Remember, also, as you are joining, you know, guys, the shape of a graph of a sine, how it is supposed to look like. So whenever you are drawing, put in mind also the shape, how it is supposed to look like, all right? So here, we're just gonna join our points from this point to this point here, all right? To this point, which is our turning points actually here. As we reach this point, it is now at its minimum turning point, then it goes up to this point, all right? So let us just have this properly here to the last point. So this is starting at zero, it goes to three, which is your maximum point. It cannot exceed this graph, that's our maximum. Then as it goes down, it is limited at what? At one. This is the minimum point. So these are turning points, all right? These are your turning points. All right, let us move on. So this was the graph of what? Of f of x. So this is our f, which was given as 2 sine x plus 1, all right? Then we move on to g. According to g, we have got 0 versus 2. So they are at the same point, 0 versus 2. I'm going to mark the same point there. 90 versus 0, all right? So we've got 90 versus 0. Remember I said any part of y, as long it is equal to 0, this y on the y-axis here, as long this y here is equal to 0, it means you are talking about values that are found on the theta axis. All right, this is actually x. They gave us as what? As x, not theta there. All right, so this is x, guys. Let me just put it this way. This is your x, all right? I forgot to remove this. So this is your x. So meaning to say, in the x-axis, y is going to be equal to 0. So whenever you have a value of a 0, you mark it in the x-axis, all right? So 90 versus 0, you mark it in the x-axis here along this bold line that we see. So that's 90 versus 0. 180 versus minus 2, 180 here versus minus 2, which is somewhere here. 270 versus 0, again, we are back to 0, all right? We mark it on the horizontal in our x-axis. 360 versus 2, 360 versus 2, which is on top there. All right, remember the graph, of course, its shape is supposed to be like this. So as you are drawing, bear in mind of the shape. So we are going to have our graph, which is taken from the point 2. All right, so we're going to take from our point 2 to our point 90 versus 0 at this point. Then it goes to the turning point. It only has this turning point here along. From 0 to 360, it goes up to this point here like this. All right, so this is what you're going to have at the end. So this is the graph of what? Of g. So this is our g of x, and this is our f of x. So as you can see, these two, they intersect here. They also intersect here. And from 0 to 360 degrees, f is on top. This f is above gx. So meaning to say f is greater than gx, all right? And gx is below, meaning to say it's less than f of x, all right? We'll talk about that. Let us see our questions. The questions that we are now given here is use the sketch, all right? Graphs to answer the following questions. 3.21, write down the range of g. Remember, range, these are the y values that are limited to g, all right? So g is limited where in terms of the y values? This is our g here. As we can see, guys, our g, it can be taken from the minimum value, which is at negative 2. It cannot exceed this point of negative 2. It cannot go below this. So it is at negative 2. It goes up, but as you can see, as it goes up, it cannot exceed 2. It is now going down, just like the previous case, it is now heavy going down. So it won't be able to exceed positive 2 up here. So it's taken from in within negative 2 up to positive 2. That's your range, the y values. So it's limited in within. So meaning to say our y values, they are going to be taken from negative 2 up to positive 2. Or you can simply say, or you can simply have it this way, or we can have it as y is greater than or equal to minus 2, but less than or equal to 2. Minus 2 is there, is included, but it won't be able to go below that, like minus 3, minus 4, all right? So that is why I'm saying minus 2 is included, The same thing, two is involved. That's why we put greater or equal to. On this side, we put less or equal to, all right? So that is what you're gonna have on that part. Let us consider 3.22. On 3.22, you are now given for which value or values of X. So it can be a value or there can be values we do not know, all right? Of which or of X will F decrease, all right? Sorry for that. Will F decrease? So we want a condition where F is decreasing. Remember, if you're given just like a shape like this, increasing is going up when you are from this side, right? When you are, this is your turning point. When you are from this side, you are going up. So that's increasing. A decrease, you are now from the turning point going down like this. This is a decrease. So we want a condition where the function is decreasing. All right, so let us check from our graph. This is from F. From F, if we check from point at 0 degrees in the X here at 0 degrees, which corresponds to this point, our graph is still going up. Our graph is going up, it is going up, it is going up, up to this point, which is the turning point. So this one is your turning point, which is actually your maximum turning point, which is on top like that. So as it reaches the maximum turning point, we expect it to decrease. So now it is going down, right? All along here, it was an increase. Now it is going down. From this point, it is going down, it is going down, until it reaches a turning point at 270. This one, it's a minimum turning point. It's again a turning point that we see, but it's referred to as a minimum turning point. So at this point here, the graph was decreasing. Along here, it was decreasing up to that point, not to say at this point, but from this point up to this point, the graph is what is going down. So there is a decrease that is happening between these points, between the points of what? Of 90 degrees to the point of what? Of 270 degrees. There is a decrease there. Our function is going down. So that's a decrease. Let's move on from 270 degrees to 360. As you can see, from 270, after this minimum turning point, the graph is now going up. It is now going up. So it's now an increase. So meaning to say, our function, it only decreased from this point at 90 degrees up to this point at 270. These were the limits from 0 to 90, like I mentioned before. So that means our interval or the x values, it is going to be taken as x. Remember, we are saying when it is decreasing. So 90 degrees is not supposed to be part of your solution. This is where it starts to decrease, but at 90 degrees, at 90, it's at the turning point. And at any turning point, there is no movement. I told you guys about this, that at turning point, there is no movement. The function or the graph that you have, it's stationary. It does not move. It is at what? At hold. It is what? It is stationary. There is no movement there. So meaning to say, 90 is not going to be involved, because we want when the graph is what? Decreasing. There's a movement, there's a decrease. So X must be greater than 90 degrees. Instead of saying equal to, we are not going to do that, because at 90 degrees, if it is equal to 90 degrees, it means there's no movement at 90. It is stationary. It's not increasing, it's not decreasing. The same thing as at 270. Our graph is not increasing, it is not decreasing. It's stationary there. But the moment it moves from that 270, it is now increasing. So 270 is not supposed to be part of our solution. So it is supposed to be less than 270 degrees. So these are the values of X that you're going to consider in within or in between 90 degrees and what? And 270 degrees. So that is how you're supposed to have this question. So guys, you need to properly understand your information, how it is given. You need to properly understand it. That can actually help you a lot. All right, then we've got question number 4. The points are S, U, S, right? R, U, and S are given. Determine the midpoint of these points. All right, so in this case, these are just points. We do not know what is happening with these points. All right, there's another question down here. So maybe I can just do it on top. All right, no problem, no problem. let me just take my points here. RS, RU, and this and that and that and that. All right. So we are given the point R in that case, which is 2, 5. All right, sorry for that, guys. That is 2, 5. And the point S, which is given as, that's U, not S. U, -2, 1. -2, 1, which is our U in this case. All right, that's -2, 1. And S in that case at the end, this is -2, +2, 3, +2, -3, like this. I just hope everything there is fine. All right, 2, 5, fine. That's it, which is fine. 4.1, we are given from these persons, determine the midpoint of RS. All right, we need the midpoint of RS in this case, R and S. These are the points that you are given there. So remember, guys, we can be able to determine the midpoint of any point. You can represent capital letter M for the midpoint, or you can just write midpoint of RS is equal to, all right? But I'm just going to use the midpoint, this capital letter, this one, for the midpoint, all right? So I'm going to have the midpoint of RS, which is the average of the X values, X1 plus X2, or you can write XR plus XS, because you're talking about point S, over 2, then the Y value, the Y on point R, the Y on point S. You can do that, or you can just write Y1 plus a Y2 over 2, so that you don't just fall into temptation of substituting wrongly your points. All right, so that is the midpoint of RS in this case is going to be, we just take this is, we are considering the point R here and the point X. So this is your X value, X value, Y value. So you consider your X values added together, all right? So we are going to add our X values. That is, you've got 2, you've got 2. So that's 2 plus 2 over 2. Add your Y values, the Y value here to the Y value there. So that is going to be 5 plus minus 3 like this over 2. So this is what your calculator is meant for, guys, to simplify such expressions. 2 plus 2 over 2. Yes, we can see that 2 plus 2 is 4, and 4 over 2 is going to give us a 2, which is fine. Or we can just use our calculator at once. All right. So remember, on our calculator, we still have our calculator in the table mode. That's why you see it's right. It's giving us f of x. We need to go back to the mode and change this to the first mode, which is 1, the compact, which is 1. So you can press 1. It is now on the normal part. We do not have that f of x. So this is what you're going to do as a fraction, 2 plus 2 over 2. So that's 2 plus 2, everything over 2 like this. So that is going to give us a 2. Then we move on to 5 and negative 3. So that is going to be 5 plus a negative 3, everything over 2 like this, which is going to give us a positive 1. All right, so that is going to be the midpoint of RS, all right, which is 2, positive 1. That was the first question. Then we are given, find the coordinate of the point T, all right, which is, we are supposed to calculate the coordinate of point T so that RUST, which is rust-like, if we just take it that way, RUST forms what? A parallelogram. So this shape, it forms a parallelogram. So you know, or we understand, guys, concept of our parallelogram, all right? So we need to calculate the point of T, whereby RUST, all right? So we've got 4.2 in this case. So this was 4.1, actually, all right? So it's 4.1. So they said RUST, it forms what? A parallelogram. And we are supposed to find the value of T, the coordinate of the point T. All right, let us think this way to say we've got a parallelogram in that case. All right, so let us consider maybe just a sketch, right? Do not know if we're going to have exactly according to our Cartesian plane, if it can make sense. This is X and this is Y there. All right, let us just say we've got a sketch. Negative 2 and 1 can be found on top. It's supposed to be RS. And so on, the order is supposed to maintain, all right? Our R here, which is 2, 5, it can be somewhere on top here, all right? which is our arrow, which can be on top 2, 5 there. Then 2, -3, which is down here, all right? 2, -3 can actually be, we are at the same point, but we are actually down maybe somewhere there. Are you seeing what is happening, guys? Oh, I'm seeing this alone. Like to say, if there's a 2 here, you're going to be able to draw this. It'll be like a straightforward, something like that is straightforward because we are at the same point of what? Of positive 2. Then we've got -2, 1. -2, 1 is going to be kind of down because this was at 5 on top there. Maybe 5 is somewhere there. A 1 can be somewhere here and then -2 somewhere there, something like this. So you see that it is automatically or gonna form a parallelogram because let's say I've got a -2 and a 1, maybe somewhere there. Yeah, it's gonna form a parallelogram, maybe somewhere like this. Gonna join this way, like this. So it means it's gonna be slanted a little bit, very, very slanted like this side. All right, this sketch, guys, do not worry about this, all right? Do not even worry about this whole sketch that I'm doing here. This one, do not even worry. The order, just draw something like this, all right? Just put your, as long you maintain the order RS, RUST, all right? You still obtain the same answers, all right? So this is R, this is U, we said U, -2, 1 here, and this is our S, and this must be our point T, all right? So you're gonna have our point T. We need a 2, -1 as our S, so it's gonna be R, U, ST, all right? So this S is supposed to be a negative then T. So as you can see, this one cannot actually give us exactly what we want on this triangle, guys. Let us just put it this somewhere. Okay, we can just put it, maybe me with not doing this rightly. Let me put it this way, guys, so that you can just do this because you might have end up with a confusion. You know that this is gonna give you a parallelogram, isn't it? So just put your points the way that you understand, just draw your parallelogram in this case, which is referred to as what? As the RS, RUST, right? The properties are just the same, the RUST. So that is gonna be, you can just name the way that you want, RUST, as long you maintain like the order like this, all right? RUST, you maintain the order. All right, maybe there's just a wrong interpretation that they gave us, but it was supposed to give us like this. So if they interpret it wrong, then it's going to be a problem on that part, okay? So with this part that we are given here on RUST, just going to have your points, which is your R in this case, which is this one, U, and so forth and so forth. So the question is that we are supposed to find the coordinate of the point T. This is what we want, the point T. So what is it that we understand about the diagonals in this case of a parallelogram? We know that these diagonals, they do bisect each other, all right? They do bisect each other. So if they do bisect each other, it means this point here is a common midpoint that we see here. It is a common midpoint because these diagonals, they bisect each other. So the point that we have here is going to be a common midpoint. So we are going to take advantage of that because we want to calculate the value of T where we do not know it's just going to be X, Y like that. We do not know the coordinates of T. Having the coordinates of U that we are given, our U in this case given as what? As -2, 1. All right. So considering that scenario, we can use the common midpoint because we calculated RS between R and S. We calculated the midpoint of this, the midpoint of RS, which gave us what? 2, 1. So we have the point here at the midpoint, which is what? Which is 2, 1. The midpoint is common and we have it. So what are we going to do with this idea? We are simply going to calculate the same midpoint that we calculated, but equating now to the midpoint that which is 2, 1. So I'm going to use the point T and the point U to calculate the same midpoint. Remember how I calculate the midpoint. For the X values, I add x1 plus x2 over 2. So if I do this, I must obtain the x value at the midpoint, which is what? Which is at the midpoint, the x value is 2 from that midpoint of what? Of RS that we calculated. So we're going to use the midpoint of RS that we calculated which is this one now, 2, 1. So for the x values, you equate to 2, whereby x1 plus x2, we are simply talking about the x values from the point what? From the point t and what? T and u. So we are referring to the point t and u. At t, our x, we do not have the value, so I'm just going to write as x plus. At u, the x there is negative 2. So that is going to plus be minus 2 like this over 2 is equal to 2. So as you can see, we have formed an equation that we are supposed to solve for x in that manner. So you can cross multiply. This is same as over 1. So you're going to cross multiply 1 this side, 2 this side. All right. So if you multiply by 1, guys, it does not even affect because 1 times x is just going to be x. Plus and minus, we know that it gives us a minus. So this will be equal to 2 multiplies 2 on that side, which is going to be a 4. So you can transpose negative 2 to this side so that it becomes a positive 2. So x is going to be 6. 4 plus 2, guys, that will be a positive 6. All right. So there we are going to add. Like I said, you have to transpose negative 2 to this side so that it adds. So it's going to be positive 6. So this is your x value. For the y value, you're going to do the same thing about the same midpoint. We know that for the y value, you're supposed to add the y1 to the y2 like that over 2. We get the value of y at the midpoint, and we have the y value at the midpoint. Remember, our point does not change the order xy, so it must be equal to 1. The y value at the first point, which is our t, because we're talking about t and u, the y value we do not have, so it's just going to be y plus the y value at point u, which is a which is a positive 1 there, over 2, must be equal to 1. And this is same as 1 over 1. So you can just cross multiply to find the value of y in that case. So 1 multiplies everything here. So that's same as 1 times y here, which is y plus 1 times 1, which is 1. This is equal to 2 times 1, which is 2 on this side if you cross multiply. So we can find the value of y if we transpose the 1 to the other side. That means you are going to subtract. So y is going to be 2 minus 1 on this side. So if you subtract 1 on this side, you're going to be left with a 1. So this is going to be the value of y that you're going to have at the point t. So therefore, our point t is going to be given as, remember, x versus y. So our x value, which is 6, our y value, which is a positive 1, right? So that was why we're supposed to have our point what? Our point t. But like I said, you can even present it on a Cartesian plane properly. Then you calculate from there. I just hope, well, there was just a slight mistake that I just did there. All right, so. But that is how we're going to have it. Just use your midpoint because you know the properties of what? Of a parallelogram, guys. Okay. Then here they are now saying, calculate the length of RU, leaving the answer in said form. Right, 2 marks for that. The length of RU, right? That is here. We do not even need our diagram. We can just calculate. You've got the point R here and the point Q. All right. So that's 4.3. And now on question 4. Oh. Guys, we have moved. Okay, no problem. That's 4.3. We need the length of RU in that case, right? RU, that is the point R here and the point U. So remember, from our distance formula, RU is going to be the square root of x2 minus x1 squared plus y2 minus y1 squared. So we just have to subtract our points. Like if we say R is going to be our first point, U is going to be our second point. You take it that way, it means we're going to have x2 as the x value at point 2, which is negative 2 minus the x value at the first point, which is 2. All right, so that's squared plus y2, that is the y value at the second point here. This is our y value, remember xy. So our y value at the second point, which is 1, minus the y value at the first point, which is a 5, like xy. So this is going to be a 5. Then we square this. So this is going to give us the length of RU in said form. That is, you leave your answer under the square root. All right, so just going to simplify everything there under the square root. The numbers that we have here under the square root, just this part of these numbers under the square root. So don't put the square root, all right? Don't put the square root, just put a bracket like this, minus two like this squared, all right? Plus, open a bracket, that's one minus five like this squared. So this is gonna be 32. So we have got the square root of 32, which we cannot simplify. So that's, you leave it like that because we can't simplify the square root of 32. But if you simplify on your calculator, the square root of the answer, it is going to be given as 4 square root of 2. So this can be given as 4 square root of 2. You can write it as 4 square root of 2 in simplest form. It's still in set form. In set form means your answer is supposed to remain with the square root. That is in set form. So here it's a set form, which is not in simplest form. Here it's a set form in simplest form. So they are just one and the same thing. All right. Now the question is, given that, all right, 8 marks, why 8 marks here? Let us see. Given that RIU is parallel to SP and SP is equal to 2RIU, find the coordinates of the point P so that RUSP forms a trapezium. All right, we are no longer having a parallelogram that we had before. Now it's a trapezium. All right, let's see. Let's see. This one I want us to properly see. They are saying these two sides, they are parallel, and RIU is, this SP is 2 times RIU. All right? So if we've got RIU SP, you're going to have just like a sketch here. All right? Let's say this is R here, USP. But we told that RIU is a little bit smaller because SP is 2 times. So remember the shape, a trapezium can be like this, right? That's a trapezium. As long as these two sides here, they are parallel, gonna have perpendicular to the ground, which is fine. But these two sides, they must be parallel. Like I said, we can also indicate our perpendicular height concept, which is fine. So there we have got, if we take it the way that you are given or in this order, because you're supposed to have it as what? RUSP, but RU must be parallel to SP. RUSP is going to be RUSP, and it must be SP must be on ground because they said SP is 2 times RU. So as you can see, this side is a little bit bigger than this side. All right. So that means this order can work, RUSP like this. And they say this one is 2 times RU. Remember the length of RU, we have it there, which is what? The square root of 32. This is the length of RIU, which is the square root of 32. And they told us that SP is 2 times RIU, all right? SP is 2 times RIU. So it means this RIU, we're gonna multiply it by 2. Or if you use this one, or you use this one, whatever that you have, if you use this one, you're gonna multiply it by 2, which is 2, the square root of 32. If you use this one, gonna use it as 4 square root of 32, you multiply, it will be 8 square root of 2. So you just choose which one to use between the two answers, like I said. All right. So this is what we have, the length of SP. As we can see, RIU is parallel to what? To SP. These two, they are parallel to each other. And that is the only part that we have. Do we have even points here? All right. We are not given any points. So the question here was to find the coordinates of P. We need to find the coordinates of this point here, P, which you can just write as XY, just like what we did on the parallelogram. But this one is a trapezium, meaning to say we are not having the properties of a parallelogram that we used, right? So that was our question 4.4. This is the sketch. All right, let's reason. What else are we given? We've got the points, all right? The point R25, all right? Just gonna use those ones that we're given before. So those 25 here. All right, the point U, that is -2, 1. All right, -2, 1. This one, do not worry about the side where it is. What about the diagram? Say, is it the right diagram? All right. The point S, 2, -3. The point S here, 2, -3. These are the points that you also have, 2, -3, like this. Okay. Now I'm going to ask myself to say, All right, this is enough, guys. Let me answer the question now. I'm going to ask myself to say, because I need to calculate the value of X here and the value of Y. That's the point P. All right, we need a lot of space here. So I'm going to need to calculate the value of X. By calculating the value of X and calculating the value of Y, I'm obtaining what? I'm obtaining the point P. All right, let's see if we can form equations. If we had this equation and also equation of this line, guys, we were going to simply solve our equation simultaneously. We find P, but we are limited. We can't do that. We can't do that. So there we just need to form equations. We just need to form equations, or we need to form equations in X and Y and solve. So where are we going to obtain these equations? That is the question. Because as you can see, we are supposed to solve for two unknown values. We do not have the midpoint concept. There we took advantage because there was a midpoint, but yet there's no midpoint on a trapezium. So we have to form our equations. All right, let us start with the one that we are given about RS, all right? We just need to form equations in this case, guys. We can use the length of PS, which is because we've got X and Y here. Here we can't use this one because there is no X, there is no Y. These are values. So whatever that you do here, it gives you an exact value, like the length, which is the square root of what? 32. But if you use this point P and S to calculate the same length here, your answer is going to be left in terms of X and Y. So let us start from the length, all right? So from the length, all right? From the length of SP or PS, right? From this length, we are going to see that we have got the distance already, which is our length, 2 square root of 32. And we understand that the length is given from the formula, the square root of x2 minus x1 squared plus y2 minus y1 squared. This is what we know about the distance formula, this one. This is our distance formula. And there, the distance is given, which is 2 square root of 32 for SP. So you're going to equate this to 2 square root of 32. So what does it mean? It means I'm just going to need to substitute here. Let us substitute our points. Remember, we are dealing with the point or with the line SP. So you're going to substitute there to say, according to our point here, P, we've got X. So it is going to be the square root of X in that case minus the X that we have at this point S, which is 2. So we need the X value, which is 2. So that's X minus 2 squared, all right, plus the Y value at point P, we do not have, so it's going to be Y minus, well, so it was supposed to be Y minus the Y value that we have this side, which is a negative 3. So negative, negative, remember, guys, it gives us what? A positive. So this is going to be Y plus 3 to the exponent of 2, all right, which gives us the length of PS, which is the length of SP, which is 2 square root of 32. So as we can see, we have formed an equation in X and Y. There's X there, there's Y there. So let us see what's going to happen with this equation. We can square both sides to remove the square root. As you can see, there's a square root there. So to remove this whole square root that we see there, we are going to square both sides. We also square this side like this. So that means we are going to be left with what is inside of the square. You have removed the square root, so you remain with this part inside of your square root, which is x minus 2 squared plus y plus 3 squared, all right, like this, which is equal to, you simplify this part on your calculator. So that is how you can have this simplified, guys. Let us see what you're going to have on our calculator. Open the bracket, that's 2. The square root of 32 like this, just move aside, square it like that. It's going to be 128. So this is going to give us 128. Okay. as I can see here, guys, on this equation that I have formed, it's true that I have formed an equation. It's very, very true. I have formed an equation, but it limits me a lot because I do not have even x or y. So there's nothing that I can even substitute. If I have another equation, let's say x is equal to 2 plus y, I can just substitute here. I form an equation where there's only y. I solve for that y. If I had an equation, maybe y is equal to x, I can substitute x in place of y, then I solve for x, but I do not have any other equation. So what am I going to do, guys? All right, let us leave it here, because here we are stuck. There's nothing that we're gonna do. Let us just say this is our equation one. All right, let us go back to our diagram again, to our sketch, and think along the lines of forming another equation in terms of x and y. So that definitely we are going to solve these ones simultaneously. The first one we formed from the length. Here we can't use the length. All right, we can use the length actually on this part, but we do not have the answer like for SP. If we are given the length to say, for RP, if we're given the length, maybe square root of 3, we could have formed an equation. We equate to that, but we do not have the length. The same as this part, we do not have anything. In fact, here the points are complete, so there's nothing that you can do. All right, so what is left is we have got RU where the points are complete. Where can we form an equation that carries X and Y? We can form that from the equation of the line. Also, we can do that on U and S. They are complete points there, so we can form an equation of a line because the equation is the one that we know it can carry what? It can carry x and y at the same time. So for the second equation, we can formulate it from the equation of a line. So this time from US. So like I said, you can use US or you can use RU. You can use it from RU. You can also form from RU. You just choose what you want. Form an equation here, all right? So from US, we are going to form an equation. An equation, form an equation of the line. All right, we are going to form the equation of the line. Definitely, it is going to be in terms of what? It is going to be in terms of X and Y. So we are going to see that our answer is going to be left in terms of X and Y. Once it has X and Y, we can be able to solve because there we left another equation that carries X and Y. So it will be easier for us to solve. All right. So let us bring back. How do you find the equation of a line? Remember, I said from a line, you can consider Y is equal to MX plus C from our analytical geometry, where if Y is equal to MX plus C, we understand that M represents the gradient, which is the change in Y over the change in X. All right. So we're going to just find the gradient. Remember, we are focusing on the line US from U to S. So we're going to need the gradient of which is M, that is the change in Y over the change in X, Y2 minus Y1 over X2 minus X1. So on the line US, this is our line US. We're going to consider the Y values. Can say this is my first point, this is my second point. So the y value at the second point, which is -3, minus the y value at the first point, which is 1, over x2, that is the x value here at our second point, which is 2, minus the x value at the first point, which is -2. So as you can see, we've got negative, which is going to give us a positive. But don't worry about that. Your calculator does its purpose. That's the purpose of your calculator. It plays a bigger role in our solving of our daily mathematics. So that's -3, -1 over 2 minus 2 is going to be a plus, or you can just write it as a plus, or you can just use your calculator minus and you press this minus here, you get the answer as a -1. So this is our M, which is equal to -1, which is the gradient. So what I'm going to do is to substitute this M into this equation so that I can be able to determine an equation in terms of y and x. So M, we got that it's -1. So it's going to be -1x, which is -x plus c. Okay, Now that you have the gradient, you substituted it here. What are you going to do to find C? Because C is a constant. Remember, C represents the y-intercept. So you can find the point C from any of these points, either the point U or the point S, as long you are focusing on the line that you used, that you are using to calculate its equation. As long you focus on the points that are on the line that you are using to find its equation. So you can take the point U or you can take the point S. So in this case, I'm just going to take my point S, which is 2 minus 3. There I have got the X value and also the Y value. So you use any point of your choice, you're going to have the same answer, all right? So the Y value, which is the Y value here is minus 3. So minus 3 is equal to minus X, our X value, which is 2, all right, plus C. So to find C, I'm going to transpose negative 2 to this side, it becomes a positive. So negative 3 plus 2, it becomes a negative 1, which is equal to C. So this gives us an equation at the end because we have it. Therefore, we're going to have it as y is equal to minus x plus c. So we are going to have it as minus x plus c. We calculated our c. We got our c that it is negative 1. All right. So this was supposed to be the equation. Or maybe you formed from another line, you obtain another equation. I don't know what you're going to have there, but you're supposed to form another equation in X. So now that we have got two conditions or two equations that we have, this is our second equation. We can now solve for X and Y. We calculated from the equation. We had to form an equations and solve here. That was the major part of our statement, to form the equations and solve. But in order for us to solve, to form, we started with SP, the length of SP. There we had to use the length. We formed an equation in X and Y. As we can see, we move on to the equation of a line. We form an equation, again, X and Y being there. So with these two equations, guys, it's now in your hands to solve these two equations. How are you going to solve? It's got nothing to do with anything about analytical geometry. It has nothing. This is now you and your solving. How do you solve for X and Y given these two equations? Since Y is the subject from equation 2, I can substitute, equation 2 into equation 1. So I'm going to substitute this into equation 1. That is, where there is Y, I'm going to substitute minus X minus 1. So you're going to see that this one is going to give us x minus 2 squared, all right, plus in place of y here, I'm going to substitute minus x minus 1 like this. But remember, there is a plus 3, which is already there. So it's going to be plus 3 squared like this, right? So that's it. We are going to have minus x minus 1 plus 3, which is a 2. So that's 3 minus 1, which is going to be a plus 2 like this. Okay, so that means here I'm left with minus x plus 2. All right, I'm left with minus x plus 2 being squared. All right, so this will be minus x plus 2 squared. If we substitute y here, we are going to be left with minus x plus 2 squared. All right, which is equal to 128. So there we are left with an equation that is only in terms of X. So that means we can be able to solve for X. Remember, guys, I talked about the expansion of this type of an expression. If you are given X plus Y squared, that is going to be X squared plus 2XY plus Y squared. That is the first term plus the last term when being squared. You're going to square the first term, the product of two and X and Y, first and last, plus last squared. When it is for squared, we also have a condition of factorization of cubic, but this one is on expansion of brackets. So our first term here is X, so it's going to be X squared. All right, so you can just expand, or you can just open two brackets. It's your choice, all right? Or you can just expand direct. That's going to be X squared. 2XY, that is the product of these two. So it's going to be 2 times the first term, which is X times the last term, which is negative 2. So that's 2 times negative 2, which is negative 4x. So this will give you negative 4x All right, negative 2 squared, that means here y squared. So we're going to have negative 2 squared, the last term squared. So that is going to give us, all right, so it's because there's a plus there, you're going to consider be a plus, right? So it'll be like that, guys, okay? So I just hope you understand what I'm trying to say. So that'll be a plus 4 in that manner. So if you consider this on this side, you're going to have the same thing, minus x squared, the first term squared, so it's going to be positive x squared. Then 2xy is going to be 2 times x, which is negative x times y here, which is a 2. So if you multiply this, you are going to get a negative 4x, 2 times 2, that's 4, times negative x, so it will be negative x. The last term squared, that is 2 squared, which is a 4. So this is how we could have simplified this. Or you can just, guys, expand your brackets properly. Don't panic. Whenever you see this type of a question, expand your brackets properly. The x minus 2 squared means we have got the product of two brackets that you're supposed to expand. Remember, from our expansion of brackets, we talked about this. We've got the product of two brackets, x minus 2, x minus 2. So you're going to multiply by x here, x times x, which is x squared. X multiplies here, which will be minus 2x. We are done with x. You move on to negative 2, negative 2 times x, which is negative 2x, negative 2, multiply to negative 2, negative, negative. Remember, it's a positive, so that would be positive 4. So collect your like terms from your calculator. Negative 2, negative 2 gives you negative 4. So it's going to be negative 4x plus 4. So this is the part that we are seeing here. X squared minus 4x plus what? Plus 4 up to that term. All right? You do the same thing on your expansion. This time we have got the bracket of negative x plus 2 squared, which is negative x plus 2. So the concept does not change. Negative x to negative x, negative, negative is a positive, so that's x squared. Negative x to positive 2, negative and positive, that's a negative. We move on to 2 versus negative x, which is negative 2x, 2 versus 2, which is a positive 4. So that will give you x squared minus 2 minus 2. That's minus 4x plus 4. So you can even go to the longer way. As you can see, x squared minus 4x plus 4, which is the same thing as what we just had from the previous case. So it simply tells us these two expressions were actually the same. These two were actually the same because they are giving us same answers at the end. So if they were the same, all right, I'm going to explain this way, because we recognize that this one here, the answer here, and the answer here are the same. So it simply means this part here are the same. The bracket of x minus 2 squared is equal to minus x plus 2 squared. All right, I'm just going to write this. I'm going to explain that later on. I'm just going to leave it like that if they are the same. All right, now let us consider our like terms. We've got 1x squared here, 1x squared. We're going to add our terms, 1 plus 1. That'll be 2x squared. You move on to x. So there we've got negative 4x, negative 4x. So negative 4, negative 4, that is negative 8x. We move on to the numbers. That is a 4, and this is a 4. So you're going to add 4 plus 4, which is 8 in that case, which is 128 on the other side. So as you can see, we have formed a quadratic equation, and we know that from our quadratic equation, we're supposed to have one of the sides equal to 0, ax squared plus bx plus c must be equal to 0. So you have to transpose this so that we remain with a 0 on that side. So that means we are going to obtain 2x squared minus 8x. Then we subtract 8 minus 128. Just use your calculator, straightforward, guys. You simplify this direct on your calculator here. That's 8 minus 128 like this, which is, oh, I didn't put 8. 8 here minus 120 like this, that's negative 120. So this is negative 120 equal to 0. All right, so what you're going to do is that, yes, we have got your quadratic equation, but as you can see, something common, a 2 is common throughout, so you can divide by 2. All right, so here we are simply going to divide by 2, divide by 2, we divide by 2, divide by 2, each and every term. So this will cancel, you remain with x squared minus 8 divided by 2, which is minus 4, or you can use a calculator, minus 8 divided by 2, or minus 8 over minus 2, minus 8 over 2. You can do it that way, like this, minus 8 over 2. You still get 1 and the same thing, which is what? Negative 4. So this will be negative 4x minus 120 divided by 2, which is 1 and the same thing. So you're going to have minus 120 over a 2 in that case, which is negative 60. So this is negative 60 equal to 0. All right, so once you are at this stage, you are supposed to solve. All right, you're supposed to solve this. Now, remember, we are at the last format of our quadratic equation, and we are supposed to solve this. How so? How can we solve this part? Remember, by factorization, guys, by factorization, we can be able to factorize this so that we obtain the values of x. Remember, I told you guys that here you're going to just consider to say I have got the coefficient of x squared being 1. So I'm going to have two brackets there, all right, equate them to 0. All right, so considering that I've got x squared, so I'm going to multiply x and x to give me x squared. So it means this will be x and this will be x also. Whenever the coefficient of x squared, this will be 1, this will be 1. So you work with a constant now, which is negative 60. This is where you focus on, and negative 4. So what you need there on negative 60 are the factors on negative 60. You are going to need the factors, two numbers that you multiply to get negative 60. But if you add those two numbers, they must add up to negative 4. So we need factors of 60. And these ones of negative 60, I mean, and these factors of negative 60 should add up to negative 4. All right, that is the case. So do we have factors of 60 in this case that will add up to negative 4? Yes, we have. Try your multiplication, this and that, guys. You see that we can think of the numbers that we multiply to get 60. Think of 10 and 6. There's a possibility of getting a 60 there. But to get a negative 60, it means I must have a negative 10, or I must have a negative 6 like this. We get a negative 60. There's so many numbers. Talk about 12 and 5. All right, we get a 60. But to get a negative 60, try negative 12 and try a negative 5 on another one. There's so many values. Talk about 30 and 2. Try negative 2, negative 30, 30 and negative 2. There are so many numbers that we can multiply them to give us a negative 60. But as you are trying these numbers, remember you are bearing in mind that these two numbers, they are supposed to add up to negative 4. So I can't use any other number but unless it adds to negative 4. And the numbers that were based there is negative 10 and negative 10 and 6. If we add these two now from our calculator, we get a negative 4. All these ones, if you add, no matter how you add them, they are not going to give you a negative 4. Yes, they are factors of negative 60. We are not saying they are not factors. They are factors, which is true, but they do not add to the middle term, which is negative 4. They are supposed to go back and add up to this number here. They are supposed to give you this term. If not, then they are not. All right, so we are going to consider these two numbers. We said negative 10 and what? Negative 10 and 6. All right, so you're going to have negative 10 and 60 here. Negative 10 and 6, not 60. Where am I getting the 60? All right, negative 10 and 6. So it's either one of these brackets must be equal to 0, as we know, guys, so that you can be able to solve for x. X minus 10 must be equal to 0, or x plus 6 must be equal to 0. Or by just looking here, you can say, transpose this, it becomes a positive. Transpose here, it becomes negatives. But this was supposed to be the normal way. Then x is going to be a positive 10 when transposed that side, or our x is going to be negative 6 when transposed on that other side. So that is how we're supposed to have the value of x. But we haven't answered our question, because our question did not ask us to calculate x. No. Remember, we are solving simultaneously for x and y so that we answer for the point P. So when you say there are two possibilities of having the point P, since there are two values of x. So to find the value of y, we can substitute in any of these equations, but it's best for us to go back to equation 2. to equation two, where y is given as what? As minus x minus one. So y is equal to minus x minus one from equation two. I'm gonna substitute from equation two. So from equation two, y is equal to minus x minus one. So you're gonna substitute when x is negative 10, y is going to be, so there, just substitute on your calculator straightforward, or you can, yes, you can write it down, which is fine, but this simply means that we've got minus our x in that case, which is 10. So it's minus 10 like this, minus one, minus 10, minus one like this, which is minus 11. All right, when x is minus six, you do the same thing. Our x, you put a negative six inside here, a negative six like this. So this will be a positive five. So y is going to be equal to positive five. All right, so that is what we have. So now as the points, therefore we can conclude. Remember, P is the point that we are supposed to calculate, which I said is in the form of x and y. So we have the value or the point x corresponding, which is 10, the point y corresponding, which is negative 11. So this will be 10, negative 11, all right? The x value here, the y value that we got corresponding to each other, it gives us a point. The same thing on the other combination that we got, there's another combination here where we said our P can also be given as the value of x, we got negative six, and the value of y corresponding at negative six was a positive five. So these are the possibilities that we're supposed to have our angle P as. I mean, the side, the point P as, the coordinate of the point P. All right, this was a whole lot of question, guys. All right, but anyways, that is how these questions can be, actually. Yeah, sometimes it can be like this, where they just need to, yeah, they want you to stretch your mind's further here when it's like this. So as you can see, it was just a nice question, very, very nice to study or to work with. These are questions that are actually nice to work with. They give us a lot of things to explain, a lot of things that you need to know. All right, that was 15 marks on everything, but 8 marks for this only part that we have here. All right, no problem. Let us check the other part of the question, which is question number 5. And that is question 5 here. We are given complete, that is the statement, complete the statement, if the opposite sides of, if the opposite angles of a quadrilateral are equal, then the quadrilateral is, if the opposite angles are equal, that's a parallelogram. Remember, a parallelogram, we have got this parallel, parallel, this one and this one, they're equal, this one and this one, they're equal. So this one is a parallelogram. Know the properties of your shapes, guys, all right? That's a parallelogram. So with that, they also gave us in the diagram below, A, B, C, D is a quadrilateral, right? They just told that it's a quadrilateral that we have. E is a point on AD so that AE is equal to this side, AE is equal to AB. So what do we know? From the equal sides, the angles that are opposite will be equal, all right? This side, it is opposite to this angle, this one opposite to this angle. So it means this angle B1 is going to be equal to angle E1, all right? So this will be X. These are opposite angles equal opposite what? Opposite sides, all right? So this will be X. All right, then we're also given AC from E to C, it is equal to C to D. So these two are also equal. So it means this side, I mean, this angle 2X must be equal to the angle corresponding opposite to what? To the equal side. So this will be 2X also, as this is 2X, all right? So this is what we are given. What else? So that is it. So this is 2X, this is X, and so forth. So we obtained that from the concept of what angles that angles opposite what equal sides, all right? So the first question was to determine the value of X. How can we determine the value of X? All right. Here we do not have anything complete. Here we do not have anything complete. Here we do not have anything complete, all right? But here we've got everything that we want from those properties that we want. We can use properties of a straight line here. These are on a straight line, and we know that angles on a straight line, they add up to 180 degrees. So it means, remember we said angle E1 before, because yes, just like gonna need some steps, 5.21. All right, so let us just write some other points that we just talked about, but remember I talked about them, but I did not indicate there. So I said B1 and E1 will be equal, angle B1 will be equal to angle E1, which is equal to X. There we talked about the opposite angle side, that is angles that are opposite what? Equal sides. Then also the angle at E, we said angle E3, all right? This is E1, not just E, but E1, all right? Then angle E3, this one, we said it is equal to angle D, which will be 2X. So the whole of this part that we are talking about is from the same theorem about the angles. So this is about the angles that are opposite equal sides. All right. So that is the case that we are having. So from there now we saw that this, if this is X and this is 2X, we are now considering angles on a straight line. So if I add these angles, if I add this X here, all right, to this right angle, remember right angle means 90 degrees. So if I add to 90 degrees, I also add this 2X, which is on this side here, I am supposed to get what? Angles on a straight line, which is 180 degrees. So this will be 180 degrees there. We are talking about what? Angles on a straight line, angles on a line. All right, they are supposed to give us what? 180 degrees on a straight line, all right? So as long you are considering a straight line, you are supposed to obtain what? 180. So the question is now, how can I obtain X? Because already I formed an equation. The equation is there. So this is same as 1X. So I'm going to just add 1 plus 2X, which is 3X plus 90 degrees is equal to 180. So there I was going to simply transpose 90 to the other side. It subtracts, all right? So 90, when it goes this side, it becomes a negative. So that's 180 minus 90, which is 90 degrees. Then we can divide by 3, to find exact value of X. So X is going to be 30. If you use your calculator properly there, you are going to obtain the value of X being 30. So analyzing this, we can conclude that if X is 30, let us just have a conclusion that we can make. If X is 30, it means this angle here is 30 degrees. This angle here is 30 degrees. This is 2X. 2X means 2 times. 2X, it means 2 times that X, which is 30. So 2 times 30, which is 60. So this angle is going to be 60, and this angle is going to be 60. So this is an isosceles triangle, guys, because it will be 60, 60, 60. Remember the properties of an isosceles triangle. We subtract this from 100, you're going to obtain 60 here. So this is an equilateral triangle, this one, all right? All right, anyways, no problem. That is, we are just analyzing, isn't it, guys? We're just analyzing our question. All right, then now they are saying here, we are supposed to prove that A, B, C, D is a parallelogram. All right, so since we have got angles, therefore let us prove here, because we talked about this before. We said if the opposite angles are equal, then the quadrilateral is a what? Is a parallelogram. So let us prove with angles. So to prove with angles, what it means is that, all right, let us do this way. All right, let me do this way. Remember we calculated this. We are just gonna prove with what? With angles. All right, so let's see if the opposite angles in this case are the same. Because here, all right, let us check what is happening here. This angle is 60 degrees. All right, this angle at D is 60 degrees. All right, and we are told that these ones are the ones that are parallel. From the concept that you're given, you're only given the one that is, the other one you're not even told that is parallel. So to prove there, we just need angles, guys. There's no way, because we can see that from our parallel line concept, right? From our parallel line concept, this one that we see, it gives us a consideration that this angle, all right, which is D, this angle at D here, and the angle at C together combined, they are supposed to add up to 180, remember, from our fan. All right, something like this. So we've got the interior angle from our parallel line concept. These are co-interior angles. They add up to 180. So the angle at D and the wall of this angle at C should add up to 180. Remember, here I told you that is 60 from my calculation, but now I want to consider the wall of the angle C, not C1, not the wall of the angles is the one that I'm indicating. So it means from our co-interior angles, angle D plus angle C should be equal to 180 degrees. That is, we are now talking about what? The co-interior angles in this case, right? So these are co-interior angles. So we can find the angle C, right? Let's find angle C. This is 60 plus angle C should be equal to 180 degrees, right? So that angle C is going to be transposed 60 to that side. It becomes a negative. So that means I'm going to obtain 180 minus 60, which is 120 degrees. All right. So it means the angle at C is 120. Okay. From our calculations, this wall angle at C is given as 120 degrees. So we used this from parallel lines. This was from parallel lines. To say these two lines are parallel, then we consider the co-interior angles, which is true. So what we are supposed to prove, because we said we are going to use the issue of angles to say these angles that are opposite, they are supposed to be equal. So if they are equal, therefore we are supposed to prove that, okay? Let me remove this. Because we calculated angle C, it is opposite to which angle? Angle C is opposite to what? To angle A. So we are supposed to prove that angle C and angle A are equal. So if we can prove that, therefore it's a parallelogram. So here, find angle A. So since we have the angles or the numerical values, we are just going to determine our angle A and C if it is equal to what? To C, because A and C, they are opposite. They are supposed to be equal if it is a parallelogram, this one. But if they are not equal, then it's not. So let's find angle A. Where can we find angle A? Remember, guys, we got that X is 30 degrees. So we substituted our X there. So this is 30, this is 30. So to find angle A using the concept of angles in a triangle, all these angles in this triangle, they are supposed to add up to 180 degrees. So if they add up to 180 degrees, I'm simply going to equate everything, add up everything and equate to 180. That is the angle A plus 30 plus 30 should give us what? 180 degrees. So we are going to have to form an equation, angles in a triangle. So we said angle A plus 30 degrees should give us 180 degrees. We are now talking about angles in a what? In a triangle. They must give us 180 degrees from triangle ABE. So this is from triangle ABE. This is the concept. So you can calculate the angle A, just add up 30 plus 30 there, which is 60. So that means we are going to have our angle A plus 60 degrees equal to 180 degrees. So that's angle A is going to be equal to transpose this side. So that will be 180 minus 60 if we transpose this side. So it's going to be a negative, and that will give you 120 degrees, okay? That will be 120 degrees. So as we can take a closer look, the angle A and the angle C are equal. And remember, that is what I said we are supposed to prove, because these two, they are opposite angles. And we said if the opposite angles are equal for a parallelogram, for a quadrilateral, it means it's a parallelogram. So since here we can see that angle A is equal to angle C, which is equal to 120 degrees. Therefore, our quadrilateral, which was given as what? ABCD, all right? So therefore, ABCD, what is a parallelogram? So therefore, ABCD is a parallelogram, all right? So the idea there, we are now back to the same concept that we talked about, what? Having what? Opposite angles equal. in a what? In a quadrilateral. So that means it is a what? A parallelogram. Okay, so guys, as you can see, it was just a nice question, this one. It was just in terms of the angles. You don't have those deep proofs that we used to do. No. This one, it was just a direct proof. There was nothing much to consider on this question. But anyways, we just have a lot of things to work on and to revise on. I think that was all right. The last part of our question here. In this quadrilateral that we see that is given here, they are saying the diagonals AC and BD bisect, all right, at O. They bisect the diagonal and the diagonal. To bisect means to divide into two equal parts. That is to bisect, to divide into two equal parts. If AC is 4xy, that is our AC, the wall of AC is 4xy. So if they say it bisects, it means from A to O, it's a half. From O to C, it's a half. That is to bisect. So I'm just going to divide 4xy like this, divide by 2. So this will be 2xy. So meaning to say from A to O, I've got 2xy. From here, I've got 2xy. From here, I've got 2xy because we are told they bisect each other. All right. BC is x squared plus y squared. The whole of this BC, this side here, is given as x squared plus y squared like that. All right. And we are given that BD, that is the side BD, this one, which is another diagonal, is given as what? As 2x squared minus 2y squared like that, which is a diagonal. So you're just going to need the half because you're told it bisect. So if you factor out a 2, because 2 is common here, you're going to have x squared minus y squared like this. So this is your BD. We haven't changed anything. We just factored out 2. But from B to O, which is the half, and from O to D, which is the half, we say they are equal because they bisect each other. So you're going to divide by 2 to find BO, which is equal to OD. You just have to divide this by 2. So it's going to be 2 into x squared minus y squared like this, divide by 2, which will remain with what? X squared minus y squared. So this is the length of BO. From B to O, it is going to be x squared minus y squared. From O to D, also, it is going to be x squared minus y squared. So that if you combine this, you get AC, which is 4xy. If you add these two, you get 2x squared minus 2y squared. That was the idea of this. So the question is, prove that A, B, C, D is a rhombus. Again, it is to prove. All right. This one was also a nice question because we can consider that. We know that from the properties, if truly this was a rhombus, we know that these diagonals, they meet at what? At 90 degrees. Right, the diagonals, they bisect each other, which is true, but they bisect each other at 90, whereby this is 90. And I told you that you form a right angle to triangle in that manner, because this will be 90, 90, 90. So you can form a right angle triangle. And once you have a right angle triangle, you can use the properties of a right angle triangle. So already we are told that these diagonals, they are bisecting each other. That one we are told. The only thing that is left is for us maybe to prove is to check if this angle can be a 90 degrees. Because they are supposed to bisect each other and they are perpendicular. For a rhombus, this one will be 90, 90, 90. So if we are able to prove that it's either B or you just work with the one that is complete, all right? If you check triangle B or C, it's a complete triangle given everything. Yes, we know that this side must be equal to this, must be, if it is a rhombus, but for now we are not saying it's a rhombus. So you work with the side where everything is given, which is B or C like this, because you don't know about DC, because you are supposed to prove. So if you work as if you know that it's a rhombus, therefore it's wrong. You prove. To prove, you are like creating, to prove that it's a rhombus, you are creating something, a statement that will give you the exact thing that truly is a rhombus. So if truly it's a rhombus, this must be 90 degrees. If truly it's a rhombus, this angle must be 90 degrees. All right, because we saw the part of bisecting, we saw it. But how can we prove that now that angle is 90 degrees. All right, so guys, I'm just going to remove this. All right, no problem. Let me remove. So like I said, we want to prove that this angle here at O is supposed to be 90 degrees. That if you can prove that, we are done, because everything is given, the diagonals are given, they bisect each other. So now simply prove that, angle BOC is equal to 90 degrees. How can you prove that? Because you're asking yourself, so how can you prove that BOC is 90 degrees? Okay, what is that we know? We know that if this angle is 90 degrees, it follows that from this side and this side, I can be able to find the third side using Pythagoras theorem. All right, using Pythagoras theorem. So it follows that if truly this is 90 degrees, Pythagoras theorem states that the hypotenuse squared must be equal to the side squared plus the side squared. So if truly this is a right angle triangle, it must satisfy that. So this is what we are supposed to prove. All right. If it does not satisfy this condition, therefore there is no 90 degrees there. If it cannot satisfy this condition, so if it can satisfy this condition, guys, we are done, as long it can satisfy this. So let us prove. We know that if it is to say this is 90 degrees, therefore we must have a condition that this OC and OB, we're going to square them, right? So you're just going to square whatever that you are given and find it in terms of BC, because BC is the one that you are expecting to be what? Hypotenuse. If there's a 90 here, therefore this one is going to be our hypotenuse. So we work it as if it's a hypotenuse, because as if we want to calculate it. Remember, we are assuming here so that we want to prove that it's 90. So we are going to consider R squared equal to A squared plus B squared, whereby our R is BC. So it's like we want to calculate BC squared and check with the answer that we are going to get. If we square this value, are we going to get the same answer as the one that we are calculating in terms of these ones that we are given here? So we know that this is going to be side squared. All right, so sorry for that, which is the side. So we put the side here where we have got X squared minus y squared, like this. So this is our side, but it is being squared, plus b squared, which is the other shorter side squared. So this is going to be 2xy, like this, squared. Okay, so that means we can calculate bc squared. So bc squared, remember guys, from our expansion, when you are given a squared like this, you square the first term squared. All right, so it's going to be x squared squared like this, which is x to the exponent of 4, then minus the product of the first and last is going to be x squared times y squared. So this will be minus 2x squared y squared. All right, you move on to the last term squared, that will be y squared squared like this. So that will be y to the exponent of 4. All right, on this one, you just have to square everything. Remember, from your exponents 2 to the exponent of 2, that is 4. X to the exponent of 2, also y being raised to the exponent of 2. All right, so this is going to give us bc squared. If we are to collect our like terms, we've got x to the exponent of 4 here. Then let's consider this. This is x squared, y squared. Oh, that's an x there, forgot that. X is also raised there, all right? So this is x squared y squared. This is also x squared y squared. So if we add, it's going to be negative 2 plus a 4. These are like terms. So negative 2 plus 4, that will be a positive 2. So that's positive 2x squared y squared, like that. Okay. Then y to the exponent of 4 has got nothing to be added or to be simplified to. All right. I want you to see what is happening here, guys. Just open your eyes a little bit. A little bit. I want you to see what is happening here. Remember, we know that x plus y squared actually is equal to x squared plus 2xy plus y squared. If it is x squared, or if it is x minus y like this, x minus y squared, we know that it's going to be x squared minus 2xy plus y squared. These are the identities that we have. This is what we just used in expansion of this. But if you check whatever that you expanded, The only part that is different is this negative, because now it's a positive. Everything is the same if you check from here up to this point here. This one that we expanded from this. The only thing that changed is this negative. Here it's now a positive. So what does it mean? It simply means here we are going to have a positive. Or you can use this concept. Say if it is a positive, it means you are also adding here. But this is to the exponent of 4. So it must be x to the exponent of 2. So it will be bc squared is equal to x to the exponent of 2 plus y to the exponent of 2, everything squared. Just like what we had on x squared minus y squared to the exponent of 2, the one that gave us a negative. So this one, because it is having a positive, this one is supposed to be a positive. All right. This is what we are supposed to prove now. This is our expression for what? For bc squared. In assumption that it is a consideration of using Pythagoras' theorem. So now we are supposed to prove to say, is it exactly what we are obtaining from our diagram? Besides the issue of the Pythagoras theorem, if we square BC, this is our BC, this one, which is x squared plus this part, right? If we square this part here, BC, what is it that we get? Remember, our BC is equal to x squared plus y squared. But as we need the square, so we're going to square that bc squared, which simply means we have got x squared plus y squared. And this is exactly what we have. All right, we squared here, so we're going to also square here. All right. So as you can see, this is exactly what we have here. And we know that this cannot happen unless we took it from a right angle triangle, because a right angle triangle is the only one that can allow us to use Pythagoras theorem. Pythagoras theorem, guys, is only from a right angle triangle. So therefore, it follows that this angle here is what? Is 90 degrees. So since we can see that, r squared, which is this part of bc squared, whatever that you have, r squared is equal to a squared plus b squared. Therefore, these ones are the ones that I replaced, bc and so forth. Therefore, it simply means that b or c is equal to what? Is equal to 90 degrees. That is what? Right angle, triangle. We have a right angle there. That is, we've got a 90 degrees. And remember, this is the condition that I said you must prove. If you can prove that b or c is 90 degrees, you have already proved that it's a rhombus, because already we are told that these lines, these diagonals, they bisect each other. What else is left is to prove the angle of 90 degrees. So therefore, A, B, C, D is a rhombus, right? So therefore, A, B, C, D is a rhombus. Think of all the papers for June, guys. This was a lot. I've answered a lot of question papers for June. But this one, it was a lot. This question part was a lot. And I can see by the time there that, oh, I've worked. It's a lot of things that I've done. All right. Anyways, guys, let us revise. Please do revise as you work through your question papers, revising for the exams that are ahead of time. Especially, we give a lot of thanks to the Gauteng province. They do a lot of things that, they enable you to revise a lot of questions. Like they stretch you further. They try to stretch you further. I want to thank you so much for that. And also for all of us guys who are revising, who are contributing to the extension of our growth of this channel. Let us just continue to share our videos to our friends and colleagues so that they also become part of the family of MathZone African Motives. Till we meet again.